Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is March 11th, 2018. This is the fourth Sunday in Lent. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Anyone wanting to order Easter flowers, orders must be in by the 19th and flowers paid for. Flowers on the altar are from the Perks family in honor of Vicki's birthday, and from Pastor and Gina Pollock in honor of Jackie and Sharon's birthday, and in memory of Gina's mother's birthday, Helen Schwartz. Our annual garage sale is coming up the first weekend in May, 3rd, 4th, and 5th. It's time to start bringing in your donations.
Good morning. And welcome to our worship service this morning as we celebrate the fourth Sunday in Lent. We give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Clark County area or looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John's your new church home. This morning we are using the service of the word that begins on page 211. So I'd ask that at this point you turn to page 211. And I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stay. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are tempted to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what you have done and by what we have done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We now begin our worship with the singing of hymn number 779 in the back of your worship book, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. Hymn number 779.
Amen.
grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Back doctor across the street in Ohio Valley, and
Springfield, Davis, that I wouldn't be done by 2. So for this Wednesday, we're meeting at 2:30. And also my thanks to whomever put the box of Girl Scout Thin Mint cookies in my mailbox. When I came in the almost Tuesday, there they were, and I can assure you they're now all gone. They're the last decision. So, thanks for whoever that was. Also, welcome back to several of our members who are back from being either out of town or have been not able to worship with us due to the inclement weather we've been having, so it's good to see you back. Let us now give our attention to the Lord.
Thank you. Court. If you turn to page 5 in your bulletin, you will find a place for notes if you wish to take sermon notes, as I know some of you would like to do. And before I begin, just to share something with you concerning daylight saving time. Last night I was on the internet and found a little article where they were talking about daylight saving time to a Native American. And a Native American responded by saying, "It's only a white man who would cut 2 inches off the top of a blanket, sew it on the bottom, and says his blanket's long." And you can make the connection what he said. It doesn't matter whether it's 10 o'clock now or 11 o'clock, there's still so many hours of daylight during the day. You know, changing the time doesn't change the amount of daylight. So it's the same as cutting off the top of a blanket to have it at the bottom and say it's long. Humble, grateful, and joyful. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In our second reading today, we read from Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus. And as this second chapter unfolds, he is speaking to them about their former lives, that is, before they became a believer in Jesus Christ. He's talking about what their life is now as a believer in Jesus Christ, and what their life will be in the future as a believer in Jesus Christ. Now, as we look at that first part that is talking about their past, we could say, well, but we are already a Christian, so this wouldn't apply to us. Because most of us gathered here grew up in the church all of our lives. We weren't like the Ephesians who had been pagan until Paul came along and presented them with the good news of the gospel. And so they had a radically different life. We grew up in the church, most of us. Those of us who were Lutheran or some other mainline denomination like Methodist or Presbyterian or Episcopalian, United Church of Christ, or Roman Catholic or Orthodox, we were baptized as a baby, brought up in Sunday school, confirmation class, always having this Christian life instilled in us. But even though that's the case, these first three verses where St. Paul is talking about the Ephesians' past life still has a message for us. And the words are still very important for us. And you'll see how the word humble comes into this first part of our text. Again, here's St. Paul as he says, "And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the children of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying with the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind." Now, as said, he's talking about their past life, but there are still truths for them today now as Christians, just as there are truths for us today as Christians. First of all, the word dead. The word translated as dead literally means to be destitute of God or to be separated from God in his life. When we are not a believer, we are separated from God in his life. When we sin, we are separated from God in his life until we repent, confess, and receive that forgiveness. Because God cannot be in the presence of sin. And so when you are a non-believer, you are dead to God, or destitute of God, and separated from God's life. As a Christian, we still commit trespasses and sins. We are not perfect. No matter how much we try, we cannot be perfect. As St. Paul tells us in Romans, we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. But as a Christian, we do not live by the flesh, but by the Spirit of God, so that we are able, with the help of the Holy Spirit, to resist temptation oftentimes, but we end up all failing in some time or another. The word trespass then literally means to deviate from the right path, to wander off, to turn aside from the path you are on. It means to violate the law or to step over the line. Now you and I know that if we're honest with ourselves, that we step over the line, that we deviate from a path, that there are times when we wander off from God and His Word, and that is why we need confession and the Lord's Supper to remind us that we are forgiven and we still are a child of God. But we do that. We do step over the line. Now, what does that mean, step over the line? Think back to your childhood. You asked your parents if you could go outside and play. And they would tell you, yes, you can go outside and play, but don't go beyond the oak tree any of them. Or don't go beyond the flower bed. Or if you had a fenced-in backyard, then don't go beyond the fence. Well, if you opened the gate and went outside the fence, you were stepping over the line. If you went beyond the flower bed or the oak tree, you were stepping over the line. Or if you lived in the city and they said, don't go beyond the fire hydrant or whatever, if you went beyond the fire hydrant, you're stepping over the line. That is to commit a trespass. We are doing something we're not supposed to do. And of course, in our daily lives, being sinners and falling short of the glory of God, we step over the line and then seek forgiveness. This is why Martin Luther referred to the Christian as saint and sinner. We are a saint in our faith in Jesus Christ, but at the same time in this world, we still give in to the sins and temptations of the devil. When I lived on my grandmother's farm, we had signs around the farm that said, no trespassing. Of course, that didn't mean our family members and friends couldn't come, but it was to keep people from just coming onto the farm for no good, or people coming to hunt without asking permission. So if somebody came and was hunting and they went beyond the no trespass sign, they were stepping over the line and violating. And if we wanted to, we could call it sheriff and have them come out and escort them off. The old days when my mother was a little girl, my grandfather could have gone out there with a shotgun and put some rocks on them. People think step over the line. So the step over the line is to violate God's will, God's law, or Jesus' command. Sometimes we find ourselves in our life wandering away from our Christian beliefs. Now, maybe when we're in college or right after college, we become interested in experimenting with Eastern mysticism or examining some other world religion. And then we realize that that cannot compare to salvation by grace through faith. And so we come back. And just as the parable of the prodigal son demonstrates to us, when we come back, God welcomes us with open arms. Also, we remember that saying that if we feel like there is distance between us and God, make no mistake about it, it's moved. It's not God has moved away from us. We have wandered away from God. But God is always there with open arms to welcome us back. Then the word sin means to miss the mark. It means to not measure up to something. It means to fail in your purpose or to fail to obey God's word. The actual imagery of this word is that of an archer with his bow and arrow shooting at a target, and he misses the target, or he misses the bullseye. And so when we sin, we are not living to the purpose that Christ called us, which is to resist the devil and follow him. We are disobeying God's word. When I was in seminary, as I mentioned from time to time, I worked at Osterlin Children's Home for the first 3 years of seminary. And I worked with the activities director for the most part, and then I would have a shift watching the cottage, usually at nighttime, and we'd get up, the kids would get up in the morning, I'd fix them breakfast, and then I would rush home and get ready for seminary classes. But anyhow, one summer day, the activities director had the kids shooting bows and arrows at a target. And so after they left, he asked me if I wanted to try. Of course, most boys my age now, when they were growing up, we all had those bow and arrows in mind, the store with the little rubber cups on the end, and you had some target you'd shoot at, or you'd go around shooting at your little sister playing Robin Hood or playing Cowboys and Indians or whatever. So I figured, yeah, I could take this bow and arrow and hit the target. So I pulled the arrow back, and I was sure I was aiming right at that bullseye. I let go of that arrow, it didn't even hit the target. I mean, it missed the target by that much. And just kept on flying until it buried itself in the ground, so we never did find the arrow. Well, I missed the mark. That's what we do when we sin. So that is why Paul reminds us of this, so that we are humble in our daily lives. So that we do not think as Christians that we are better than other people. Or that as Christians we think we're a better Christian than somebody else because we go to church more, or we know more Bible verses, or we go to more retreats, or we go to more weekend activities, or we join the most Bible studies and other outside groups. All that means nothing when we commit a sin. And so as Christians, we are always to be humble. It's just like one day one of Martin Luther's students asked him what he thought of himself. And the student was expecting Martin Luther to say something about, well, you know, I'm a pretty good theologian, and pretty good preacher, and expositor of the Bible, and reform and so forth. Martin Luther replied by saying, only thing that's important is how I stand before God. And he said, as a human being, I am nothing more than a foul-smelling bag of maggots. With all the prestige and all the press and all the fame that Martin Luther garnished, he still looked at himself in that humble way, realizing that without Jesus Christ, he was nothing. That without Christ, before God, he was a condemned person. And so St. Paul is reminding us of these faults so that we will be humble, that we won't be braggadocious, that we won't puff out our chests. So, well, I'm a Christian, you're not. I'm better than you. But we, just like the non-believer, fall into sin. And when we fall into sin, we are in the same condition as a non-believer. Except that we confess and we have the grace of Jesus Christ. So that brings us to the second word, grateful. Why, as a Christian, should we be grateful? Each and every day, no matter what the situation is, no matter how our day is going, why should we be grateful? Beginning with verse 4, St. Paul tells us why. But God being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised up with him, and seated with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. But God being rich in mercy because of his great love for us, even when we were dead in sin, made us alive together with Christ. This is why we are to be grateful each and every day. This is why the martyrs could march into the Colosseum knowing that they were going to be torn apart by wild beasts, or that they were going to be hacked to death by gladiators or whatever. They could march in grateful because they knew that God loved them so much that he sent his only son. And so So then you that because of the sacrifice of Christ, that this death, this martyrdom was not the end, but only the beginning. And so we should live with that same grateful attitude. But God being rich in mercy, God didn't have to be rich in mercy. Go back to the Old Testament. Go back to the days of Noah. And look at how wrathful God can be. God was fed up with his creation. People have become so wicked and perverse and crazy that he couldn't stand it. But he finds Noah and his family who are righteous. And out of mercy, he saves them while he destroys the entire rest of the world through the great flood. And then after it was done and the waters receded, he promised Noah he would never do that again. And he put in the beginning of his plan of salvation, which would be the sending of his Son. In our gospel lesson today, Jesus explains that love. That the Son of Man had to be lifted up so that all people who would believe in him would have everlasting life. For his Father sent him into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. That is how much God loves us. Sends his only Son to suffer that horrible, painful, outrageous form of death, crucifixion. Because God loved us that much, we can be grateful even in the darkest of days. Even in the midst of trial, tribulation, calamity, sickness, even facing death. Grateful that God loved us so much, he sacrificed his only Son. As I said, he didn't have to. He could have left it that we had to try to earn our salvation, and all of us would have failed. But instead, he sends his Son so that those who believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. I have said this to you before. I think I say it every year around this time, but I'll continue to harp on it. It is beyond me why in the modern church, Good Friday, the churches are not as packed as they are on Easter Sunday. Because without Good Friday, there is no forgiveness, there is no salvation, there is no Easter. Easter does not pay the debt of sin that we owe. For the debt of sin that we owe to be paid, it takes blood. It takes a sacrifice. And Jesus is that sacrifice. His blood pays that debt so that we do not have to try to earn salvation anymore, but only believe in his suffering and death upon the cross. And so on Good Friday, every Good Friday, I come out hoping that at the afternoon service there'll be 50 people, and at the evening service there'll be 100, and every Friday I'm disappointed. With both services, we're lucky to have 60 people. Jesus Christ died for us so that we could be forgiven of anything we do. And we should be grateful. And therefore we should pack the churches on Good Friday to give thanks to God that he was willing to make his Son undergo that horrible death. Or had, if he didn't make him, Jesus had free will. Jesus could have come down from the cross if he wanted. He could have called down that 12 legion of angels that he tells Pilate about to rescue him from his enemies. But out of his love for us as well, he willingly goes to that cross and suffers that horrible death to pay sin's payment, its debt forever, giving us victory over. over sin and death and the power of the devil. Easter, we celebrate because that's God's affirmation that Jesus' sacrifice has been accepted. That is God saying, my son has done all that I demanded. Now you, my creation, will benefit from that death. So we are to be grateful because God loved us that much. Because God, even for the pain of having to turn his back on his son during that crucifixion, so that his son's death would be that ultimate sacrifice. So that Jesus would fulfill those prophetic words of John the Baptist when he saw him walking along the Sea of Galilee, and he was with his disciples, and he pointed to Jesus and said, behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus was that final sacrifice. So Good Friday, churches should be packed. Packed with grateful Christians giving thanks for that ultimate sacrifice. So St. Paul's reminding us always to be grateful. To be grateful for all God has done in Jesus Christ. And then we come to the word joyful. Not only should we live each day being grateful and acting humble, but we should be joyful. Verse 7, he says, so that in the coming ages, Jesus' return, he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is a gift of God. This is the point Jesus is making when he speaks to Nicodemus in our gospel lesson. That salvation does not come from us. That we don't have anything to do with it. We don't find Jesus. Jesus finds us. Jesus gathers us up and makes us his own. And so we are joyful that this is a gift. And that we have that promise of everlasting life. That we have that promise that this life is not all there is. We are joyful because we know how the story ends. When we place that loved one in a grave, or we put them in a mausoleum, or we receive that urn of ashes, that's not the end of that loved one. That's not all there is. Because we know. And because Jesus died on that cross. Because he made atonement for our sins. Because he redeemed us, bought us back from sin, death, and the devil. That we have that promise and that gift of everlasting life. We are joyful even in the midst of sorrow, even in the midst of pain, even in the midst of sickness, even in the midst of trial and tribulation. We are joyful because we know we have that place prepared for us by Jesus Christ himself. We know that we one day will join that great cloud of witnesses. Reunited with those loved ones who've gone before us, and reunited with St. Peter and Paul and James and John and Andrew and Barnabas and Thomas and Simon, with St. Jerome and St. Augustine and Pollock and Irenaeus and all those heroes of the Christian faith. joyful. No matter how much our life is blowing up around us, no matter how much or how many things are not working out as we had planned, we still can be joyful because we are that child of God, that heir to the kingdom, that child of the Heavenly Father whom he cannot deserve. We know how the story ends. We know that we go to that kingdom where Jesus tells John in the book of Revelation, there is no more death. There is no more grief or crying or pain, for the old order of things have passed away. They're gone, erased, wiped out, never to afflict us again. So St. Paul is reminding us of what it is to follow Jesus Christ. And as we follow him, we live each day being humble, being grateful, and being joyful for all that Jesus Christ has done for us, because God loves us that much. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us now sing Blessed Assurance in number 638 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 638.
Thank you.
With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Led by Christ in our journey of repentance and moved by his compassion, let us pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. Our response today is, hear our prayer. God of abundance, grace, send forth messengers into the world proclaiming salvation in Jesus Christ. Make us bearers of the light of Christ in our homes, schools, and places of employment. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Refresh the earth with satisfying water and seed-carrying animals and wind. Bring forth life from the earth in this season, that a hope and new life would be revived. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Encourage nations to work together for the sake of all people. Break down barriers and prejudices built up, and restore the dignity of every living thing. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Provide respite and healing for all who suffer. Cure all people by your expansive love, and restore wholeness of body, mind, and spirit to every human being. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Turn our hearts to praise as we are forgiven, healed, and freed from every evil that binds us. Shine your light upon us, that nothing about our life in you would be hidden. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Giving thanks for all the witnesses, teachers, and missionaries, we pray that our lives would bear Christ's salvation to all who await good news from you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. loads of cables.
Salvation needs us to our God and to Christ the Lord.
Thank you.
That concludes our service for today. Wednesday, midweek Lenten service at 2:30 and 7. And then on next week, the 18th, again at 8 o'clock and 10:30. St. John's has a food pantry open Wednesdays 9 to 10:45. They have an outreach store open 9:30 to 1, Monday through Friday, closed on Thursday. Rainbow table every Friday, noon to 1 o'clock. Everyone is welcome. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.